So that covered the very first part. What is a ledger? We still have centralized, or sorry, decentralized and distributed, because blockchain is a decentralized distributed ledger. Third one down. So let's tackle the first one. What is decentralized? To know what decentralized is, we will first describe centralized, because current day, in the current day, the centralized ledgers currently are highly integrated in our lives. So what is a centralized ledger? A centralized ledger is where one entity is in control. And as mentioned before, an entity can be a person, a department, an organization, a government agency, a big company, etc., etc., right? One party is in control. The more power is focused to one party, the more centralized the ledger is. So in the example where you are on the sidelines recording your 10 friends, all the power in the ledger is in your hands. So in this case, that's a centralized ledger with you as a trusted third party, because these 10 people in your 10 friends exchanging value, money, are trusting you to record their transactions in a decent manner, right? So the more power is concentrated to one entity, the more centralized a ledger is. Importantly here is that they are highly incorporated in our lives. We are literally surrounded by centralized ledgers. And I already gave you a quick peek. How can you recognize whether you are in a centralized ledger? You can recognize it because you often have something that has a unique ID. Because to follow something through a ledger, you need to pinpoint that thing and give it a certain unique ID number. So this can be your phone number, as mentioned, but this could also be your social security number, or your bank account, or a pass number, or a car plate, license plate, etc., etc. Something that is uniquely tied to that tangible, touchable asset, or that intangible asset, right? Because we record tangible and intangible assets. So before we go into the downsides and the upsides of centralized ledger, it is very important that you understand that these centralized ledgers are often in closed off environments. So what does this mean? In the example where you are the trusted third party and are recording the friend's transactions, you own the books, or you own the ledger, you maintain the ledgers. Other party, you can register all the transactions. The only thing the other friends can see is, okay, does the ledger actually confirms the amount of money I actually have in hand? So if I have $12 in hand, I can check the ledger, okay, do I actually have $12 in my account? But what you can't do as your friend is see what other amounts of dollars your other friends have, right? That knowledge is all owned by you, the centralized trusted third party. So this is a closed off environment. And we will explain later on why this is important, but already connecting this with previous class, of course, this is not a perfect ledger because it has a threshold. It has basically a wall built around you and around your ledger and closing off all that information for all the other parties, only giving them access to certain amounts, which makes it, of course, not a very transparent ledger, increasing transaction costs. And in the perfect ledger, we don't want any transaction cost, right? So last thing that's important from this slide is that your power is limited in this case. It is, let's say for example, that your 10 friends notice that you start abiding the rules, so that you don't follow the exact rules. For example, you're stealing money, or you're making a lot of errors in your recording. They can actually start coming together. So the 10 friends start discussing together whether to kick you out of the team, kick you out of the ledger, and appoint somebody else. So those are external entities that force rules upon you. So an example in real life would be, for example, the banking rules that are forced upon banks. So banks can't do whatever they want. They have to follow a certain amount of rules, quite a lot actually. So those are external rules. But of course, you could also have your internal rules. Like for example, when you needed to record the persons, you could pick whether to record them with only their first name, or their first name and the letter of their last name, or their entire name, or only their last name, etc., etc., right? Those are your own rules. Those are the rules that you imply on your own ledger, and those you will stick to the rules because it will help you structure transactions and work more efficient and make less mistakes, right? So two types of rules: internal rules created by your own, and external rules created by the entities around you. Often, of course, law enforcement, etc. So that's an important note, keep that in mind. And of course, that they are in a closed off environment. So let me give you an exercise. I want you to take 10 seconds. I will count down for you, but I want you to take 10 seconds and I want you to think of as many centralized ledgers that you are currently in, right? That you yourself are currently in. And one tip, just imagine your day and structure the amounts of value you transfer and where you have a unique ID number, etc., etc. And then you can think of a certain amount of ledgers. So let's try this one. I will count down from 3 seconds from now and see how far you can get. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. Hopefully you came across a few ledgers yourself. Like mentioned, this is quite easy to do because you only need to visualize it. So let's, for example, say that you visualize that you woke up. That's the first moment if you got woken up by, let's say, an alarm clock. That's your first ledger, electricity ledger, because you have a unique number, your electricity meter has a unique number, and by flipping a switch or using electricity, you're using a ledger because you're basically transacting value, because you are taking energy which has value, and later on you will pay them in money which also has value. You flush your toilet, you water ledger, you perhaps used your phone, phone ledger, perhaps use an application on that phone, the ledger in the application, etc., 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 right? Fun fact, of course, if you ate breakfast, for example, and you bought that breakfast at this grocery store and you pay with your PIN, with your bank account pass, that's recorded in the ledger of the bank. But if you paid in cash, that transaction was only recorded in the ledger of the grocery store, but the actual transfer of value wasn't recorded in your side, which makes cash a more anonymous way to pay for transactions than by banking card, which is an interesting property of cash, of course. So by now you probably have a decent idea what a centralized ledger is, and you realize hopefully that you are literally surrounded by ledgers. Before I finish this class, I will give you one more mental thought. Can you think of a way of life in current day life where you actually don't use ledgers? So if all ledgers drop down, what kind of functionalities won't you be using anymore? And what impact would it have in you as a person and the opportunities you have? So take that one with you, and I will see you next class.